I would like to start with the basics. My name is Roya. Roya means dream, vision in German or in English. And this name has been very much the guide of my life. And I would like to share with you the vision that I have for intellectual property. And in that regard, I put a few slides together. But I had a great talk yesterday with Corsula Schumacher, who said that let's not jump into the middle of it. Let's start from the zero. So if we look at, do we really need an IP valuation? I think the intellectual property in many corporations is the key asset, but it is the elephant in the boardroom. It is hardly managed, valued, or even discussed. It is the intangible, invisible elephant that we just keep passing by without really taking massive care or consideration or think about it as much as what the IP could contribute to a company, to society, to countries. And I think that's wrong. And my vision for intellectual property is that the IP stops being the elephant in the boardroom and starts being the driving force for our doings worldwide. And that IP becomes a tool of prosperity, a tool of opportunities, and an instrument where our creativity, our innovation, our ways of seeing the world really drive, are in the driving seat. And not that they are somehow like in some sort of like packaged parcel for a bunch of tech nerds who nobody really understands what they are up to. And the reason why I think it is so important to strive towards a vision where human activities being driven by creativity and innovation and by the underlying intellectual property rights that underpin it is that I don't even think we have another way forward. I don't think we have the choice to go back in time and become agricultural societies, which are mainly driven by changing what we harvest every couple of years. That ship has sailed a long time. Most of the advanced economies are service-driven economies. They are driven by smart people and smart ideas and property rights that help unleash that value of smart people and smart ideas. If we believe that innovation is what we need to do well as humans. And the COVID crisis has shown that once more, that without innovation, we would still be pretty much in a mess, probably somewhere where the time of the pest of the Middle Ages was, instead of probably soon being able to fly again. So if innovation is so terribly important to drive growth, to drive prosperity, to enhance progress, I keep being astonished by the fact that we have such a massive gap between intellectual property and innovation. Sometimes I wonder if we're really still talking about the law of innovation, not the law of something, I don't know, something else. And the IP valuation, in my opinion, can bridge that gap. It can bring a vision to the world where we are able to put the monetary value to intellectual property rights and not just to talk randomly about some sort of patents or copyrights or trademarks where we are not really, where we are mainly discussing their validity or their infringement. It can offer an amazing bridge, which I think is the missing link in a new vision for IP, which is a new vision for an era where innovation systematically drives prosperity. So what can be the motivations for an IP evaluation? Most recently, I wrote about Michael Jackson and the value of his brand and his reputation. And it was very interesting because there was a case in the United States where they had to figure out how much taxes the estate had to pay after his death. And amusingly, after I wrote about it, I got contacted by the lawyers from Diego Maradona, who said, "We have the same problem. When our football star in Argentina passed away, we are now trying to figure out what the value of his trademark, of his brand, of his reputation is." So moving away from superstars and football, to more like the ordinary folks in this world. I think that many companies may be missing out on opportunities associated with IP management and with open innovation. And this can be the underlying reason for that is, in my opinion, that IP is too strongly looked at from a legal perspective, and we are missing out on the chance of systematically associating IP with business opportunities. And when I started talking about this, meanwhile, 20 years ago, to lawyers, I thought like, oh dear, we're coming from different planets, because what they heard, like, well, let's start a business opportunity in litigation. And I thought, that's what you do as a lawyer. But the normal world does not immediately think, let's start a business of suing and defending. There is, between creating a patent and enforcing it, there's a huge middle ground. It's not sort of like we have a patent, then we see if you use it or you don't use it, and then we start a fight and we try to get some funding out of it. I find that a terribly rudimentary business model. The domain of open innovation opens, gives way to a whole bunch of other opportunities associated with IP, and evaluation can allow to achieve that. Other advantages of an IP evaluation can be financial reporting systems. We are currently working with INTA, the Trademark International Trademark Association, on establishing a standard to improve current shortcomings in financial reporting systems which don't adequately allow to recognize IP. For example, American Airlines last year issued got a 100 million securitization on the grounds of its trademark or against its trademark. And what a lot of trademark owners are wondering, can we get something along those lines for other brands? And how would we do it without engaging in massive speculation? So it's opening up new ways of conquering the world. And this is why I find it so exciting. Transfer pricing, tax purposes. In the UK, we have the lovely controversial patent box regime, which Germany is heavily criticized, but still, if you can show value, you can get the relief on corporation tax by 10%. I'd say, why not? If the valuation gives you relief on your tax bill, why are companies not using it more? Mergers and acquisition are another good example. Without the valuation, you may be buying the cat in the bag without knowing what you're getting yourself into. It can also lead to misunderstandings, or to simply getting really inadequate assessments of the value of a company when you're not looking at the value of the IP assets. The book value of a company very often does not reflect the value of the IP, and that can lead to very odd situation where the book value of a company is 10 or 20 million, and then the acquisition price is in the hundreds of millions, and that's the IP value very often. What is probably of most interest to this group here is the issue around licensing and litigation. And my personal vision for IP is that we eventually move away from contentious litigation fighting to building bridges, to being trying to find avenues to create IP business networks instead of being on each other's throat. That is my personal hope for the world. And I would also hope, that's why I put licensing and litigation in separate steps, that I thought, like, let's hope eventually in the future this will not go hand in hand, especially in some sectors, but that's not yet where we are. And sales, acquisitions, you want to know what on earth you're getting yourself into. These are just a few examples of where I think an IP valuation can be really enable a company to manage risk or to establish business opportunities for its own intellectual property. We have still an underutilization of patents. I think IP valuation can help that. It can help repurpose abandoned research and development, and better connect IP management to industry life cycles. We talked about the past and the future. So we pulled this data out from the IMF, and I think in spite that we still don't have breakthrough patent utilization, the IMF suggests that the deal volume for licensing revenues of intellectual property and intangible assets in general has basically doubled over the last 10 years. That's huge. I mean, if this keeps doubling at that speed, this is becoming a really important source of revenues for the world. And interestingly, developing countries and China are massively catching up here. So perhaps historically, with a smaller deal volume, it doesn't matter. You stitch your finger in the air and you sort of like say, I think that's the value, and the other one says something else, and off you go. I just tend to think that the more importance this market is gaining, the more we will be obliged to have a systematic assessment of what we are really trading. With such a trading volume, this is not anymore really just a sightseeing grid for a few tech nerds. This is starting to become serious business.